is it. They passed fast track into the full Senate. The vote's set for tomorrow to make Obama king. But first, John Bowne's report on the attack on the Second Amendment that they've now launched.
Around 9 p.m. Charleston, South Carolina time, horror ensued at the Emmanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church on Wednesday. A church immersed in an American historical past involving freedom of religion, rebellion, and oppression as America grew from its Reconstruction roots. Attacked by modern society's ills. A lurking sickness that is completely ignored as the clear exploitation of the hearts and minds of good Americans goes unchecked. Within hours, guns and white people were being blamed. Hours after that, on the heels of getting his Trans-Pacific Partnership nearly to the finish line, a trade initiative written by corporate lawyers and designed to bypass our government and rights to a world government run by big banks, President Obama backed up the fool's rhetoric of gun confiscation to the nation.
It is in our power to do something about it. I say that recognizing the politics in this town foreclose a lot of those avenues right now.
Obama has armed himself with a far more powerful weapon than a gun. He has executive orders, and he means to use them. Regardless of the fact that gun violence has dropped by 49% in the past 20 years, 56% of Americans believe gun crime is worse today than it was 20 years ago. Well, who can blame them? From 2007 to 2013, there were 16.4 average mass shootings per year, as opposed to 6.4 shootings annually from 2000 to 2006. According to FBI crime statistics, there were 1,043 casualties and wounded Americans as a result of these attacks from the year 2000 to 2013. Well, maybe President Obama is right then. No, he's wrong. The facts are right. Facts that blatantly show he is ignoring major factors contributing to the increase. There are key players to blame at work here. The pharmaceutical companies being public enemy number one. Psychiatric drugs have contributed to nearly every mass shooting incident in the last 20 years. But you won't find Obama blaming them. They gave him $20 million just for his 2008 campaign alone. The other culprit is gun-free zones. 92% of mass shootings since 2009 occurred in gun-free zones, according to the Crime Prevention Research Center, which created a study as a response to the statistically misleading Every Town for Gun Safety study. Blaming all white people, which angers all ethnicities that aren't subjected to the mental illness that is racism, is the other go-to dig used by the liberal media agenda. Salon's blood-boiling disinformation article, Charleston Church Massacre, The Violence White America Must Answer For, could be the most racist piece of garbage I've read in recent memory, insinuating it is the fault of the right-wing media, claiming white men and white families are violent, and saying all white America is violent. I can't help but challenge the author, Chauncey DeVega, to a debate. Just go look at the data, Chauncey. Black folks are killing black folks, and white folks are killing white folks. But when it comes to black on white and vice versa, blacks double the number of whites. But I digress. The U.S. government has been trying to take black folks' guns for a long time. But black folks aren't going to sit idly by and listen to the president's rhetoric. And neither is the rest of America. As Obama's border amnesty unleashes more criminals onto American streets, criminals fleeing countries where guns are illegal. Last year, I reported how NC Fire was tabulating the full-blown crisis of child rape by illegals in North Carolina. New numbers show that there were 518 charges of child rape by illegals in North Carolina in the month of January 2015 alone. There has never been a more important time in recent history for Americans to have a gun in the house to protect themselves from what is quietly happening to American families. White, black, plaid, or otherwise. God bless the sweet and righteous fallen souls we lost Wednesday night. May the truth behind their deaths not be in vain. United we stand, divided we fall. John Bowne for InfoWars.com.
We're here live Monday through Friday from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Central Standard Time. I'm your host, Alex Jones. I say this almost every broadcast now at the beginning because it's true. I cannot believe the position I'm in, the position you're in, the position this whole planet is in. My life is basically somewhere between ecstasy and agony. Best of times, worst of times. There is so much fantastical things going on. So many incredible developments culturally. The information we have at our fingertips. The just amazing discoveries. Life is incredible. But hiding behind all that good is a rapidly growing, cancerous, metastasizing, viral, goo that is basically cultural, historical fraud. And it's systems based on deception, based on thievery, based on disinformation, based on dumbed-down populations that is the scourge of humanity. We need to be at our highest level operating to be able to not destroy ourselves. We need to be absolutely tuned into our better angels, not our bad ones. And the ruling class is so greedy to control and dominate the future and wall us off from it as they play savior of the world, that we don't have a lot of hope right now on the course we're on. That much is clear. The buildup of NATO arms on the Russian border is unparalleled. Mainline historians, military analysts, German members of their military, their top staff, are all on record saying this is insane. Regardless of what side you're on, I'm not on either side. I'm on the side of humanity not wanting to destroy ourselves. And in the midst of that, removing the Army of Northern Virginia Robert E. Lee battle flag, you would think is the only story in the country. Or Caitlyn Jenner. Nothing against Caitlyn Jenner. Nothing against the battle flag. It's a distraction, though, overall. But within the whole battle flag discussion, you get a window into the abject ignorance of the public across the board, including Southerners who are obsessed with the League of the South. I've studied history. They don't even know what really went on. I mean, it is an ocean of idiocy. An ocean of ignorance. And I'm not on some high horse here saying this. I'm just very frustrated by it. It's like a physical punch in the stomach . A physical attack when I get up in the morning or I'm reading the news in the evening and I get the word that Obama trade, as it's called, has advanced out of the Senate committee. It's already passed the House and is set to pass the Senate tomorrow. That makes me physically nauseous, like I got a phone call that a dear family member is on life support. And the average trendy will say, why do you care? Fast track, smash track. Things have always been corrupt. Just go along with it. There's nothing you can do. No, things haven't always been like this. When people have a laissez-faire attitude, they get conquered and enslaved every single time. And we are being conquered by very wicked globalists. It's not like we've got conquerors that are bringing us aqueducts and language and medicine and agrarian society. We're being conquered by exterminist globalists that Hitler was just a spinoff of. It's ridiculous. And there are 48 Republicans that are going to vote with Democrats in the Senate to pass Fast Track. The Republicans have a majority in the Senate, and a large portion of them, almost all of them, are set to vote on it with a minority of Democrats, and this is suicidal to the country. There is no doubt it's illegal. There is no doubt it's tyrannical. We have three subsections of 28. WikiLeaks won't release the others. It's got a bunch of gun control and stuff they like in it, and open borders and everything else. But Senator Sessions has seen it. Walter Jones has seen part of it. It's thousands of pages. You have to go in and read it one page at a time. It's nightmarish. And it's set to pass right now, tomorrow. Here's the headline. We're going to play the video from the Senate floor. Last chance to stop Fast Track. Senator Sessions blast ugly facts. Let's go ahead and go to the powerful breakdown from the Senate floor as he warned the public yesterday. Here it is.
Why do we have to create a transnational union? An institution that has the power, as I will explain, to impact the laws of the United States of America. It's not necessary. According to the trade representative who's negotiating and advancing this legislation on behalf of President Obama and who's advocating for it, it will be a living agreement. And that means that the entity itself, the commission, will then be entitled to make it say different things, eliminate provisions it doesn't like, add provisions it does like. In fact, the commission is required to meet regularly and to hear advice for changes from outside groups, from inside committees of the commission, so that they can update the situation to change circumstances. It is a breathtaking event. It says it's designed to promote the international movement of people, services, and products. Basically, the same language used to start the European Union. I have referred to it as a nascent European Union. I don't think that's far off base. Well, it's not just a trade agreement with one friend and ally, South Korea. It's 12 nations in the Pacific. As soon as that is inked, we've been told and brought forward for passage in the Congress. And historically, if we give trade promotion authority, the agreements have always passed that are presented. Once that one done, we will have a transatlantic agreement. And this transatlantic agreement, I suppose, also will have some sort of commission,
it
a transatlantic
three.
Union with powers to discipline and set rules outside
Hit
the
pause.
Powers of the United States Congress.
Back it up about a minute. This is so epic. I don't want to interrupt it. I'm going to play it up to the break, come back with more of it. This is one of the main leaders of the Senate, a guy who leaked the amnesty bills three separate times. They even tried to censure him for it, but the rules say they really couldn't do that. Senator Sessions is a super patriot. So is Rand Paul. They're not perfect, but compared to the others, I mean, they're just absolutely night and day. And here he is talking about the Atlantic Union, merging the North American Union with the Asian Union, with the EU. That's the trilateral plan that Barry Goldwater warned of. And the reason he says it's breathtaking, shocking, over the top. In fact, when I sit here and watch this, I catch myself not breathing because it's shocking. America is being conquered right now by secret boards and we can't even see it. It's epic. And I got a big vocabulary, man, but it's epic, 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 breathtaking. And The reason we're in so much trouble is the average American doesn't even know this is going on and just goes, trade deals? It's not a trade deal. It's Congress transferring what little power it's got left into the hands of the president to commit us to an international agreement run by the very same people that founded the European Union as a trade deal in secret. England and the UK were brought into this thing 20-something years ago and never got a vote. It's taken close to 30 years just to get to the point where England is going to get, and the UK, a vote on whether to stay in the EU or not. They never voted to get in it. That's what this is. They don't tell you it's a takeover. It is a takeover of free speech, of our guns, of our borders. And just flood the country with third world labor and drive everything down. Raise the taxes when the ultra rich are exempt. It is a hellish race to the bottom. This elite are the same people arming ISIS to run around killing Christians. I mean, they are ultimate villains beyond any movie you'll ever see. Coming up in the next segment, we're going to look at the ban on the Army of Northern Virginia. That's what it is. It's not even the flag of the Confederacy. And why this is so important. Because it really shows ignorance 360 across the board. I'm going to give you my breakdown on it. I'm not going to give you my take. I'm going to give you the facts. The way it really is. And what this is really all about. But right now, let's go back to the big issue at hand. Our country being conquered by a foreign secret conglomerate. And it's hardly even a news item. And they act like we're traitors because we don't want to go along with it. Absolutely incredible. This is how countries die in the 21st century. World government that the Pope just called for last week is upon us. Here it is.
Well, it's not just a trade agreement with one friend and ally, South Korea. It's 12 nations in the Pacific. As soon as that is inked, we've been told and brought forward for passage in the Congress. And historically, if we give trade promotion authority, the agreements have always passed. That are presented. Once that one done, we will have a transatlantic agreement. And this transatlantic agreement, I suppose, also will have some sort of commission, a transatlantic union with powers to discipline and set rules outside the powers of the United States Congress. And then there's going to be a services agreement. It's already been talked about. It's been leaked. Somebody leaked it. The other two are secret and can't be seen by the American people. Some of my colleagues have been saying that the trade promotion authority that the president is so desperately seeking, he's been hammering and bludgeoning his members in the Senate and the House to get them to not vote their conscience, but vote with what he wants. They say, we should pass it because it restricts the power of the president. Well, give me a break. If this were true, why would the president want it? If he could do all this he wants to do without Congress, why isn't he doing it anyway?
It's secret.
The entire purpose of Fast Track is for Congress to surrender its power to the executive branch for 6 years. Legislative concessions include control over the content of the legislation. The president negotiates it. He brings it back. We can't amend it. He controls the content of it.
Hit pause.
The power to fully consider the legislation.
Back it up 5 seconds. And the power the globalists will amass through their puppet president, that's why the Republicans are going along with it. They want that power for 4 years. Obama will just have it for two. The power that will be amassed by that combine will be almost impossible to reverse. I mean, already we're run by globalists, but this is the coup de grace, the final blow. This is the coup d'etat, which is French for coup d'etat. That's a joke. Let's go back to this just over the top information happening. This is how republics die, with a trade deal and a bunch of lawyers. That's secret. And then we get subsections of it, and it's so draconian, I can't believe they're doing this. I mean, they're bold. But you got a bunch of folks worried about battle flags and Caitlyn Jenner. And playing with their iPads all day. We are a conquered people. Make no mistake, we're already conquered that something like this could even be attempted. This is gang raping the country by cold-blooded globalists that all over the third world, they'll just come in under deals, take over a river, a water supply, a reservoir, and they'll quadruple prices overnight and let all the crops die and just bankrupt everything for 5-10 years and come in and take it over. Famous cases of that all over the world. I mean, you want to be brutalized by globalists while they fly around above you in jets and helicopters laughing at you because they love you so much. They love you that, you know, because they want to give you a sex change. They just sit back laughing at all this. You're all done. All of you that think you're part of the winning team, that think you're part of something cool, think you're part of something fun. You mainline Republicans and Democrats are sick idiots who wouldn't even support your own interest, your own self-interest. I don't expect you to be honorable people. I'm talking about establishment folks, but my God, suicidal, crazy, madmen. You want to get paid off now, 30 pieces of silver to gut this country? You're idiots. Let's go out to break with Sessions and we'll come back.
Over the content of the legislation, the president negotiates it. He brings it back. We can't amend it. He controls the content of it. The power to fully consider the legislation on the floor. It's filed on one day, voted the next day. The
rubber
power
stamp.
To keep debate open until
we're going to come back.
Culture is invoked.
We're going to come back, and I'm going to shut up, and we're just going to play the rest of it without me interrupting. But do you understand? It is a literal rubber stamp. It's Hitler taking over. It's turning the Bundestag, the Reichstag, into a rubber stamp. I mean, this is it. You're seeing incredible history happen right now. This is just over the top. We are set to see one of the greatest blows against U.S. sovereignty in our 240-year history. Benedict Arnold was not half the traitor. This is true treason of the highest kind, happening in our face by a group of miscreant lawyers masquerading as representatives and public servants. Just like they set up the EU by stealth, they're establishing the North American Union by stealth, and they are establishing the Pacific Union by stealth and already merging all three together. Once they merge the three, they then start imploding the old superstructure of the nation state and the regional governorship to consolidate it into the central world government. They use crises in their Banff Canada documents, in their Club of Rome documents. I made the film Endgame. I show you in the film where they say they're going to use financial collapse once the three unions are being merged to bring in the world government publicly with global taxes on currency transactions and energy and carbon, with everything surveilled by computers to do it. Self-driving cars will be ubiquitous. Human driving will be outlawed. Or the taxes will be so high, they will, quote, bankrupt you, to quote Obama. I told you this about 16, 17 years ago. It's now been announced by Time Magazine, Newsweek, Financial Times of London, calling for an end of humans driving cars. You're told it's a foregone conclusion. Google has set up its command base in Austin, rolling out fiber at cheaper than it cost them to give it to you, because they are, as they've now announced today, secretly spying on computer users via smartphones. We gave you the patents and the documents and their shareholder documents 10 years ago, 2005, prisonplanet.com, with a specific battle plan. It was already in place then. 18 years ago, I tore a Scientific Atlantic cable box apart on TV showing the hidden microphone. And I was told by engineers at the time that it was already recording and being sent back to they didn't know who, probably the National Security Agency, with AI computers recording everything. We're not in Kansas anymore, ladies and gentlemen, and you're now going to see that everything we said was true on record, because you're going to see it manifest in the implementation phase against you and your family. Forced inoculations, forced GMO. Forced social workers in every home. Your children taken if your 11-year-old plays basketball in the backyard. Siege teams, checkpoints, giant prisons, drones, infrared cameras, ground-penetrating radar blimps. It's all firing up right now as they siphon our resources off and take the quadrillions in money they've created in the bubble to build the grid with their giant factories turned against us, again, siphoning our energy via taxes to build our destruction. And I tell you, I get chills. I get them every 10 seconds now. I mean, it is all real. It was all planned. It was pure evil. And Google's all pretty downtown with blue, non-threatening walls, and they have their doors open, and have free cupcakes and couches, and look, we're non-threatening, and all these unpaid interns who are going to be stars, and the police chief and the mayor come, and the police chief rides around in the driverless car, and it's all fun, and as humans are phased out. Google secretly testing self-driving cars in Texas. Multiple sightings confirm autonomous vehicle being used on public roadways. And this is how conditioned I've gotten. I walked out in the parking lot about 3 weeks ago, and one drove right by, and I went, oh, there's one of those Google cars that's been caught stealing passwords and jacking in everybody's computers. And I went, wait a minute. There's nobody in it as it turned the corner. And I looked for my keys in my pocket, but I'd gone out there to sign a delivery. I'd gone out the back to talk to some folks, and I didn't have my keys. And then some of the other crew told me they saw it again. So we've got Imperial probe droids. They're already in most states, driving around already without people in them. And Adan Salazar got the documents. It's up on Infowars.com. And no one was told about it. See? But don't worry. The mayor and police chief were told, and TxDOT's running it. And it's a dream because they're going to tax you by the mile. Well, you know, self-driving cars are safer. You got to pay more insurance to be a human driver. And already they're phasing us in. They're already phasing us in where our cars are already basically self-driving. But it's something fancy you pay extra for. Oh, I get to thumbprint with the Mercedes to get in it. Oh, the car, someone sent their brakes on. The car saw it. It braked for me. Oh, it told me, and it all sounds great, but studies are already out showing just a few years into this, it's already making us where we're not good drivers. We don't know how to back up. We don't know how to look both ways. We're reliant. And they came out this week or Friday and announced, yes, we're programming the self-driving cars of the future to kill you if it's going to save someone else. It'll decide, and the Watson computer will decide who doesn't get treatment and dies. That was illegal just a few years ago, but now it's okay because the computer decides, not just the bioethics board. And the bioethics board sit back and say, well, we can't get in trouble now when we turn grandma off and don't give her water when she's begging for it, or don't give a veteran health care because the computer said so. See? But it's programmed by the globalist. And then they got the New York Times endorsing the Zeitgeist movement Fresco and all these socialists and communists who call themselves futurists, where we're all living sports stadiums, plastic sports stadiums. There'll be no more money, and the robots will assign us our work. It's a utopia. No, it's a hellhole. The end of free will. Oh, but it's an underground movement endorsed by the New York Times and the UN. Isn't it cute and trendy sit around in black suits and talk with simpering voices about re-educating Alex Jones and how cute it is? And they have an arrogance towards the dumbed-down public. When I come out and say, how dare you, live on air, say I'll have to be re-educated, they go, we never said that. Apologize when it's on audio. You will be re-educated. You will be re-educated. Well, that's a horrible authoritarian statement. I never said that. I control reality. You don't. Obamacare is free. Ha ha! I mean, this is how these people operate. And they're just ushering in a hell that is the end of them as well. But they like to make believe they're part of the power structure. So let's go back to Senator Sessions and the move to ram through TPP tomorrow. Call the Senate. Call their local offices, physically go into their local offices, physically call into talk radio in your area and say, hey, cover this. Because while we're busy talking about Charleston, which is very suspect, and while we're busy focusing on all this other stuff, they're moving NATO arms in to fight the Russians, unprecedented escalation. Europe is melting down financially. We're going under world government. The Pope's calling for it. I mean, this is crazy. And by the way, this is a normal response to get upset to all this. Let's go back to Senator Sessions.
Consider the legislation on the floor. It's filed on one day, voted the next day. The power to keep debate open until Senate cloture is invoked. On any other legislation, you have to get cloture vote. So together, TPP, TTIP, and TISA, these three trade agreements that we know are going to be advanced on the fast track, represent the goal of advancing the unrestricted global movement of goods and people and services.
Stop again. There's no way I can't interrupt this because everything he says is so key. Just as UKIP's the fastest growing libertarian patriot party in the EU, you say, well, why don't they just vote themselves out of existence? Because they are ceremonial and can only pass things that are in accordance with the EU charter and the bureaucracy. It's now over 90% of UK laws are set by it. And then you find out the EU bureaucrats made themselves tax exempt. The new royalty. In fact, it's on my phone. I sent it to Biggs last night. We were texting. He got back from his work vacation in Hawaii, visiting friends. And I sent Biggs this photo of the King of Kuwait with the Duke of Edinburgh, Prince Philip, and the Queen of England. Absolutely sickening of them in their top hats holding his hand. I wanted to tweet this out and say, this is why we're in so much trouble. This is the exact same thing as North Korea. But we've learned to bow down to it because of red carpets and trumpets being blown. It's a sick joke. Here's my phone, guys. I want Buckley to get that off and tweet it out. I can tweet it, but I'm busy talking, and I keep forgetting to do it. I mean, that is everything wrong with the world right there. And I mean, it is an anachronism of them dressed up in their suits, their 19th century, 18th century top hats, with another guy in a clown outfit. And you won't hear a word out of the feminist. You won't hear a word out of the establishment about getting rid of royalty, getting rid of the Saudi princes, you know, where they kill women for no reason. You'll only hear about Western men being bad all day. Because Western men are virtuous and good and helped build the basic freedoms we have worldwide and brought you the printing press and the Renaissance and Newtonian physics and everything else. It must be destroyed because it's virtuous. It's the highest standard, so it's got to be pulled down. And every form of squalor and evil and patheticness that we fought and our ancestors fought has to be pulled down and wrecked. Because it can't exist. Freedom can't exist because people will lust after it. It has to be removed from the world while we all sit in poor squalor, while the elite sit there in top hats in giant armored palaces with troops guarding them. And then they're out going, the poor, socialism is the answer. Male supremacy is evil. I am the queen. Oh, Prince Boo Boo. I mean, it is such a fraud. Let's go back to the clip of Sessions' warning of the imminent takeover of this country.
The European Commission. This is how they started, how they were formed, explains. So the European Commission is explaining now. TISA, the second, presumably the second major trade agreement that would be submitted after the Pacific Agreement.
Yeah.
And we'd move to the Pacific.
EU's the boss.
European realm.
It's the command base.
And this is how they explain what it means. Quote, TISA is open to all WTO members, World Trade Organization members, who want to open up trade in services. China and Uruguay have asked to join the talks. The EU supports their applications. TISA, of course, is the services agreement. And apparently it'll be worldwide. Anybody, even China.
EU runs it.
Could be admitted to it. And the European Union Commission specifies that this services agreement, TISA, will be modeled on the General Agreement on Trade in Services, GATS. And this provides insights into how TISA will affect U.S. immigration procedure. When the United States became a member of the WTO in 1994, it signed on to the GATS and committed to issue certain numbers of work visas each year. Immigration visas. Congress's ability to control the United States' temporary entry programs has therefore been curtailed, as it would open up the United States to foreign lawsuits in an international tribunal. In other words, they made an agreement on immigration visas under work ideas as part of GATS and the WTO, and it violates and complicates our ability to enforce American immigration law. What about this union? What kind of powers is it talking about? I'm of the belief, since the president hasn't been a strong advocate of trade and his supporters, many of them oppose this kind of trade agreement, I'm becoming to believe that the primary part of his understanding of the importance of this legislation and why he's breaking arms and heads over it is the union, this international commission that has powers that he believes will allow him to advance agendas.
And he will join it when he leaves the
president. The United States is entering into trade deals.
Back it up 20 seconds. This is key. Sessions is so slick how he just lays it out calmly and nicely, but very subtly. And I'm not criticizing him because it's different strokes for different folks, but we need people to hardcore blow the alarm. The way this works is if you are a state politician, you graduate to the regional union level when you sell out your constituents. If you're a federal level, you graduate directly from the regional to the global body. And you bet your bottom dollar, Obama violated Article 1, Section 9, that no member of the cabinet or the president will sit on a foreign legislative or governing body. And he was the head for his round of the UN Security Council. And that's why they had Henry Kissinger and all these other globalists there sighing and looking like they were having orgasms. And I don't mean to use that just to be shocking. We played the video of them at the UN in New York gasping and Kissinger going, and then going, this was our dream to do this. I mean, it was so illegal to have a president become the head of the UN jointly. Not the Secretary General, that's a puppet. The head of the Security Council. It's in my film, Fall of the Republic. It is overwhelming. And in that film, we talk about the TPP. Made 6 years ago. Go watch it. It's free online. Only has like 10 million views between all the sites that have it. Very sad. Doesn't have 50-something million like Obama deception. 14 million one view. One channel. Buy it on DVD if you want it to support us. InfoWarsStore.com. I'm skipping this network break. Stations shouldn't cover it up because it's our break. Love our stations. I'm just pointing that out. Some stations, I'm told by listeners, still do it, so people wonder why I'm talking, and it just cuts off. And quite frankly, I just can't go to break at times like this because, you notice stations will skip the news when there's a big terror attack or a mass shooting. I mean, I just feel like skipping the breaks all the time because it's just so incredible. This is the fall of our republic we're witnessing. And the president wants to go on to be like Barroso, who sold out his country, sold out Spain and Portugal. He was involved in both. Going to head the EU Commission, Obama wants to go on to head it. And believe me, Bill Clinton has said he wants to be the head of the UN. I mean, that's what this is all about. Tony Blair has said it. And Tony Blair is a UN envoy to the Middle East. That's all this is. They're selling us out so they can captain the new global government that's a giant screw job operation. Let's go ahead and go back to Sessions.
What is it that we're talking about? I'm of the belief, since the president hasn't been a strong advocate of trade and his supporters, many of them oppose this kind of trade agreement, I'm becoming to believe that the primary part of his understanding of the importance of this legislation and why he's breaking arms and heads over it is the union, this international commission that has powers that he believes will allow him to advance agendas. So for too long, the United States has entered into trade deals on the promise of economic bounty, only to see workers impoverished, industries disappear, manufacturing jobs decline, and we've been on a steady decline in manufacturing jobs.
And that's just part of a 30-something minute speech. We got some clips for you. It's up on Infowars.com. And I suggest you get it out to everybody. I mean, has America just given up? Like, people know they're being screwed over, but they just think, oh, we can't stop this. We've been stopping this. They've been trying to pass this for about 4 years. They cooked it up 10 years ago. You know, they started the TPP merger. It's called the Asian Pacific Union. And then the agreement to bring you into it is the TPP. And then it merges with the NAU, and that secret treaty from 2005. You know, every time I mention that, it was in the Dallas Morning News. It was in the Waco paper, and it was WorldNet Daily covered it. InfoWars covered it. Drudge covered it at the time. But 2005, Bush met in secret with Vicente Fox and Paul Martin, the leaders of Canada and Mexico, at Waco. And they signed a secret treaty. And it was in the news that, well, you can't see it. I cover that in my film Endgame, and people would call me and say, come on, you think they signed a secret treaty making an NAU, just like this is secret. So at least we've come a long way where folks at least know this is secret and they know what's going on. I've had to deal with the uphill battle of folks just saying there is no global union, there is no global government. And, you know, because now we've gone so far down the rat hole, down the sewage pipe, that the Pope's running around saying we need global government to enforce carbon taxes. So at least we can have an open debate about this now. The raping has gotten so far down the line with the gang rape here that folks at least now know they've been bent over a barrel. And let me tell you, when they get all this through, Katie, bar the door. They're going to devalue the dollar and all the other major currencies. We're going to go overnight from rich to poor, and it's going to be a hellish police state with crime all over the place. And that's why all the money is getting out of Israel and the United States. Israel is set to go down, and so is the United States. And you may hate Israel. A lot of you, it's the cause celeb, the sexy thing with the left and everybody else. Hey, fine. But just know when Israel's been basically quasi-removed, it'll still be there, but it'll be a UN state. The radical Muslims will still be running around cutting Christians' heads off and everything else. I want to get to this special report on the dangers of not having a cleansed gallbladder. Brought to you by InfoWarsLife.com. We'll come back in the next hour. We've got a lot of big guests coming up today. I'll tell you about that after this video. But this is brought to you by InfoWarsLife.com. And when you eat all these toxins, if you ate McDonald's nuggets 20 years ago that had plasticizers in them, your gallbladder and your liver doesn't know what to do, so the liver basically excretes that into the gallbladder, and it holds it. Just Google gallbladder stones, and it's disgusting, but you need to look at it. And when you finally get filled up with these, it bursts, or it gets infected, and they've got to remove it. And we'll scroll through these. There's even grosser ones. Like, let's scroll down. On average, they're green or black. If they're black, they're really old and toxic. They're generally green. And this stuff's meant to be passed out of you, but we eat such artificial food that it doesn't. These are way beyond kidney stones, you name it. You also have liver stones. And medical doctors won't tell you on average, hey, flush your liver. They'll just say, hey, your liver's sick. It's going to get progressively worse. We're going to get you on a list for a liver transplant. It is unbelievable. We're showing these disgusting images. So about a year and a half ago, Anthony Gucciardi just said, man, I just did a Dr. Grip's liver cleanse, the one he recommends. And he's developing this proprietary stuff. He's testing on himself right now. You really ought to do it. The results are dramatic after 6 days. And I'm like, no way I'm doing it. I don't believe that there's giant black or green balls in my gallbladder. I mean, this is how ignorant I am. And he's like, look at it online. I'm not looking at it online. Stuff like that grosses me out. I don't want to go there. Well, finally, about 6 months ago, they convinced me to do it.
I personally think everybody should go through liver cleansing if you haven't done one, and then take the, for example, the Liver Shield can be taken two different ways. It could be taken as a liver support formula, where you just take a couple dropperfuls, but that's not going to purge the liver and remove all that stuff from it. In order to do that, you have to do the 6-day
liver
cleanse.
Well, I'm going to walk through how the liver works, the different types of cleanses with you, and give you the floor, but I'm asking a lot of selfish questions here up front. How does the apple cider vinegar organic with the oxy powder and with the liver trex over to 6-day cleanse, how does it then when you take the olive oil at the end, lay on your side for an hour as you go to sleep, why does it then have the gallbladder release?
Well, this is something that that is a very controversial issue, but results speak for themselves. I mean, hundreds of thousands of people have done this, and it dates back even 1,000 years, drinking oils to cleanse and purge the liver. Actually, the Greeks and the over in India with Ayurvedic medicine have done it the same way. But how it works is what you should do, and this is what our proprietary research led us to do back starting in the early 90s when we were looking at the best ways to cleanse the liver, was to develop an herbal formula that contains herbs that will help soften or break down these globules or these stones in the liver and the gallbladder. And that's really what the first 5 days is for. That's where you mix the bottle of Liver Shield. You pour the whole bottle in a gallon of distilled water, and then you drink 4 8-ounce glasses a day of that 4 or 5 days. At the same time, though, you're also using the apple cider vinegar, and that's going to be the liver flush kit that we put together exclusively for InfoWars, you know, viewers and the people that want to support the InfoWar. So basically that, once you do that for 5 days, and of course you want to eat fairly healthy, you don't want to be putting a bunch of chemicals and toxins into your body. But then on day 5 is when you actually do the...
I point out that it's the king of Kuwait, tax exempt, above the law, living in his own world. Women have absolutely no rights. Saudi Arabia executes women that criticize the government. And you won't hear a word out of the feminists. You've got the sickening so-called liberal queen who's calling to ban British free speech if it upsets anyone. UK speech being restricted. She's calling for more taxes on the people, shipping more of their jobs overseas. You've got this Transylvanian parasite, they're not even German royalty, that sits on top of the country. Can we put the Twitter image up? There with the queen, with her husband, the Duke of Edinburgh, Prince Philip, a known Nazi, he was in World War II against the Nazis, but he was a known admitted Nazi before that. He's German. He's a German prince. His cousin, Prince Bernhard, was an SS officer. And then as soon as the Nazis started losing, he ran out of Germany and ran over to the Netherlands to get hooked up there, and then ran back over to England, and then even double-crossed his compatriots, the Nazis. And then you've got Prince Charles, who wants world government and population reduction, sitting back there. You've got the Duke of Edinburgh, who in 4 different magazine interviews, AP, Reuters, his autobiography, and one other publication, calls for killing 80% of the world population with a deadly virus, or in other quotes, being reincarnated as that virus to kill 80%. And you've got them all in their clown outfits. You've got the Scottish Guard there. Isn't that what that is? With his little hat. And they're all wearing their top hats. And see, the message is, we are separate from you. We are in control. We will do whatever we want, and you will bow down to it. You will love it. When royalty in modern terms is a total joke. I didn't finish up with my report on how deadly gallstones are and the amazing cleanse with Liver Shield at InfoWarsLife.com. Your purchases of it also fund this operation and helps flush out a lot of the garbage these people are having added to the food and water to dumb us down. InfoWarsLife.com. I want to go ahead and finish up with that video. Then we're going to come back with our special guest. But here is that video.
That's where you mix the bottle of Liver Shield. You pour the whole bottle in a gallon of distilled water, and then you drink 4 8-ounce glasses a day of that 4 or 5 days. At the same time, though, you're also using the apple cider vinegar, and that's going to be the liver flush kit that we put together exclusively for InfoWars, you know, viewers and the people that want to support the InfoWar. So basically that, once you do that for 5 days, and of course you want to eat fairly healthy, you don't want to be putting a bunch of chemicals and toxins into your body. But then on day five is when you actually do the olive oil. And when you do Epsom salts, and the Epsom salts that you drink will actually help relax the bile duct and make it a lot more elastic, so any of the stones can pass through there, or the globules, the toxic globules. And then when you lay on you drink the olive oil, you lay on your right side because your liver is on the right side, and that heavy oil ends up absorbing down through your intestinal lining and going into the liver. And it kind of works like oil pulling, which is a big thing now. It was on Dr. Oz with the coconut oil, where you swish it in your mouth, and oil has an affinity for toxic substances and absorbs some of those. And when you do the liver cleanse, you will actually form also little oil globulates as well. So the reason why you take, during the reason why you take oxy powder at the same time is because you want to be able to flush that out of the system. Because when the liver dumps all those toxic balls and rocks and all that toxic buildup that's been in there for years and years and years, you want to have something to flush it out of the intestines.
InfoWarsLife.com. You flush your carburetor, got to flush your gallbladder. Larry Nichols was on with us for an hour last week. He's on with us for an hour today. Then Max Keiser joins us on The Economy. Just since I've had him on, I've seen a whole bunch of Democratic Party and White House connected hit pieces from Media Matters, you name it, doing the old tried and trusted thing they would do back in the 1990s. The Clinton Library, of course, was forced to release via FOIA earlier this year to the Western Journalism Center thousands of pages of documents. And in there, we see the Clintons, right when they were elected, ordering the media in private meetings to call anyone that criticized them conspiracy theorist, and how to attack them, saying they make money off of their conspiracy theories. And there are not one, not two, not three, but many more than that. I can't even count them all today. Articles about how I'm making all this money. And we're seeing the direct Clinton talking points right there. My gosh, Alex brings in more than $10 million a year. Why, you couldn't run this operation in New York City for $50 million a year. And it's not bad if I make money. But the main reason we run this is to stop the globalists, to stop TPP, to stop the open borders, to stop the gun control. The Clintons can raise hundreds of millions of dollars from third world dictators, giving money to their foundation and ship weapons to them after they're paid off. They can steal money from Haitian kids, and that's okay because they're the Clintons. But I try to raise enough money to pay for 50-plus employees, to send them all over the world, to pay for the servers, the building, the insurance, the lawyers, the loss, all of it. We are an incredibly moral organization. We're also capitalists, though. I got a little bit of money saved in case I get sued, or in case I get put in prison or killed or whatever for my family. You bet I do. But I'm not going to be guilted into the idea that it's bad that we have a media organization. But that's what the Clintons did. And that's their talking point. I'll be on national TV and they'll go, yeah, you just want to make money. And I'm like, well, what do you do as Fox or CNN or MSNBC? Investigative report, Nightline, Jones, building media empire. Tiny compared to what they do. And done selling good products directly to our audience. High quality nutraceuticals, high quality non-GMO seeds, high quality Patriot apparel. Of course we are capitalist. Most revolutionaries rob banks and stagecoaches, you know, like some of the founders did, and rob British ships to fund the revolution. That'd be moral, quite frankly, at this point, but I'm not going to do that. So see, the old revolutionaries could you know, rob a British gold delivery, and that's patriotic. But I'm here selling high-quality products competitively at InfoWarsStore.com and Amazon.com, and everybody else is allowed to sell stuff but me, because the moral high authority says it's bad. Brian Williams can get $10 million contract extension to a lot of the public, but that's what he's paid. Not the money we've got to make to pay for the infrastructure. I mean, quite frankly, I plow almost, when they would attack me, I'm going to Larry Nichols, 15, 16, 17 years ago, when I only had 4 or 5 employees, and when I was so neurotic and such a purist and actually listened to their propaganda, I would be in a working class neighborhood with a working class car and would put like 98% of the money in back into the operation. Because I wanted to fight the tyranny. I didn't do it because I was guilted, but still it felt good because of how they were trying to guilt me to think, well, I really don't keep any money. Then I thought, you know what? I'm going to hire a bunch of people. I'm going to really go for broke. I'm going to try to really change history. It's my responsibility. And you know what? You don't like it? I'm going to get a decent car, and I'm going to live in a nice house for my kids. And you know what? You know what I'm going to do for the Democrats and others? I'm going to go ahead and expand and really be successful and get 5 times bigger. How's that sound? Because I'm not going to sit here and watch you crooks that are selling our country out to the TPP and gutting our borders and destroying our language and taking over and be guilted by you scum. You are sick. You are absolutely sick. And they play these mind games. Jones is scaring you about the TPP because he wants to make money. What? I was offered contracts to make way more money than I make now to sell out to the system. I've been approached by the biggest networks there are out there and offered to be where Glenn Beck was before he even existed. I was approached by 3 of the biggest networks. And they told me, though, we're going to control what you say. We will have editorial control and basically final cut. And I said, I can't control what I say. I just tell the truth. Well, don't you want a $5 million a year contract? And that isn't $5 million, and you got to pay all the bills. You got to pay payroll and got to pay for the servers. That's $5 million in my pocket. I'm so moral, it's disgusting. Because I'm not going to sell people out. It's nothing special that I did that, except in a nation of traitors, I guess it is. I couldn't sleep at night if I did that and get up on the radio and lie to people and tell them there's no New World Order and sit there and tell them there's no FEMA camps and sit there and tell them all this stuff. And I mean, I will not be part of it. And the truth is, I and you, the audience, and our guests, we're going to Larry Nichols, have changed the destiny of things. You listen to Rush Limbaugh, Glenn Beck, Sean Hannity, and all of them. We forced them to admit global government and a corporate takeover. We forced the whole thing out in the open. And I'm so proud of that. That's what I was after. My goal, they say fortune favors the bold. That's the SAS slogan. Well, my fortune's freedom for myself and my family and being an honorable person. There's nothing wrong with being successful as long as you didn't screw somebody to do it. In fact, that's how you build an economy. I'm proud of people that create an invention or build a company and or develop systems or write a book or play music and become wealthy. They're the people that buy houses and buy cars and go to restaurants and get their hair done and send their kids to college. You want wealthy people, but it's the wealthiest royalty and globalists who are exempt from taxes, always lecturing us who are down here with nothing, that we're not supposed to have any prosperity. What a load of crud. So support us at InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com. You'll see me hire more reporters, hire more writers, get more people in the field, breaking more news, having a bigger effect, exposing so much. It's incredible. We salute you all. So click on the sponsors, support our products, spread the word about the transmission. They're angry at us, and we're willing to go all the way. Larry Nichols is a fella who was inside the deepest areas of the Arkansas power structure. You don't get into the Arkansas power structure, at least then, without being part of the Dixie Mafia, which I'd call quasi-criminal. I mean, the Dixie Mafia operates right here in Austin. Most of it's legitimate now. It's some of the biggest names in the city made their money in the Dixie Mafia, shipping the liquor that was produced in Little Rock and Hot Springs all over the country. Al Capone's main headquarters was there. So it's really just part of American culture. And I had family on my dad's side who were, liquor runners in Texas that were in the Dixie Mafia. But he was a high-level member of the Dixie Mafia. Clinton comes out of the Dixie Mafia and the CIA. Nichols also did special operations, which is classified. I know he can get into some of that. And I've kind of been running over him here today because I got all mad by these news articles. Not really mad, just incensed. And I wanted to just throw out that he was there and then made a break with the Clintons when they started getting into really nasty stuff like killing kids. show, kind of a real-life Tony Montana joins us, who wouldn't do the evil things and helped expose their whole agenda and warned that Hillary was coming, and now he's here to try to expose the whole thing. Larry Nichols, LarryNichols.com. It's a third-party site, but I guess he endorses it. And he's going to try to republish his book right now. And he also gives out his home number and his address if you want to support him. He lost everything by fighting these people. He's a great patriot. And going up against the establishment right now is absolutely key. So, Larry Nichols, thank you so much for coming on with us.
Hey, Alex, thank you. And by the way, I loved what you were talking about at the beginning. Folks, let me tell you. I, as you'll recall, Alex, with the Clinton Chronicles and the Circle of Power, they sold something like between Falwell, 20 million, Jeremiah Thiem, 60 million. Huge, huge numbers of those things. And I, in the interest of trying to make sure nobody could discredit me and say I was doing it for money, never took one dime. And they offered me big money, but I wouldn't take it. The sad thing was, Alex, I read all over the world that I was taking the money anyway. I should have taken it because they said I was, and I took the licks anyway.
Absolutely. I think we should spend I'm going to skip this break to give you more time. Spend some time on who Larry Nichols is and how you got into the Clintons and what you did, because you were one of the good guys on the inside. That was the point I was trying to make, was you don't even get into the power structure without being part of it.
Well, I just cannot say I was one of the good guys. I was in the middle of it. I did the nasty things. I did the dirty things.
I meant compared to them.
Oh, yeah, compared to them. Yeah, you had to go some. But anyway, I was in there. It was my job. I was a handler for Bill Clinton and Hillary when they first started running for office. I was the marketing man, I guess you'd say, for them. It was my job to keep them out of trouble. It was my job to know everything and to be in a position to fix it. Whatever it was, I had to fix it. By the way, Alex, today, before I came on with you, I get a call from National Enquirer. And they said, Mr. Nicholas, so what? Do you know the chef that was killed or died, the White House chef? And I said, buddy, they're not even in the race good. And these mysterious deaths start all over again. Isn't that something, Alex? Here they go again.
Absolutely. Do me a favor. Talk right into your phone for me, Larry.
Oh, I'm sorry. And you want to talk, folks, about money and risk? Let me tell you what Alex Jones risked. Let me tell you what anybody risks that comes out against these guys. It's a good way to end up. Even though I don't say they kill people, but the people that support them, the people that make billions off of them, they tend the business on their own. And that was one of the things I learned. And then all of a sudden, I was at a place called the Arkansas Development Finance Authority. And there, Alex, it was there that I discovered $100 million a month coming into a place called Mena, Arkansas, to a man named Dan Lassiter, and they were smuggling cocaine in and laundering the money from the agency I was working at. Now, included in that cabal was Dan Lassiter, Bill Clinton's best friend, eventually went to jail. Don Tyson, Tyson Foods, y'all remember him, right? Remember him, Alex? Remember when I came out telling about the chicken trucks hauling cocaine?
Yes.
I think you got threatened.
That's how he was able to leverage and take over the entire poultry market worldwide.
Worldwide. When Bill Clinton was elected president, Alex, Don Tyson and Tyson Chicken Food was a little regional company. And then boom. Then you got Ron Brown, bless his heart. He got involved with helping Tyson take over Alaskan fisheries. He ends up dead.
And by the way, even the Air Force coroner said he was shot in the head with a .45. That even came out in the news.
I've got the x-rays. I've got two makers came to see me. And they were the ones that did the actual autopsies. There was a sergeant, Alex, that was on that plane. She was like a stewardess. Can't remember her name right now. Now, when they got to the airplane, folks, sitting on a stump, and she was folded over crying. The rescue people came to her. She walked to the helicopter and was taken back to the emergency room at the airbase. However, when the helicopter landed at the airbase there in Germany, she was dead. Now, oddly enough, her brainstem was completely severed. Now, Alex, you know, most of y'all know, she could not have her brainstem severed and be sitting on a stump and walk to the elevator.
Sure.
Walk to the helicopter. Can't do it. The brainstem being severed is a military operation where you grab the chin in the back of the head and you spin real fast. So, yeah, you know, this is going to be a ride. I never will forget, Alex. I think you will, too. Remember the gentleman that I had that was going to testify about Whitewater and Hillary's involvement. We find out that he's at a dump in Saline County. Now, folks, it's a true story. He cut his hands, cut his feet off, cut his head off down to the brainstem, set himself on fire with gasoline, and threw himself in the dump.
And the state medical examiner ruled it a suicide, didn't he?
Sure did.
That's Arkansas.
Ruled it a suicide. Arkansas. That's what I told that reporter in inquiry. He said, I never heard that. I said, yeah, well, you will. So here we go. Folks, I'm telling, every week I hope Alex lets me. I'm going to tell you the story of Hillary. Don't believe what you think you know about Hillary, folks. You don't know Hillary. I do. Alex does. Alex is one of the few, very, very few people back during the Clinton's day that actually troubled to send people here to see if I was lying. So I could have been lying. Alex sent people here. You know,
well, Larry, enough about me, you're a sweetheart. I want to come back in the next segment, but we got 6 minutes till break. But because you are so interesting, describe what you can about secret government operations, how you got in to the whole Clinton surrounding group, just so people know who you are. Most folks do, but all the old-timers, but for new folks, and then why Hillary's so dangerous.
It's a wild story, Alex can tell you that. Anyway, folks, just know this. I was in Nicaragua fighting with the conquerors. And then I heard from Adolfo Calero that drugs were coming back in. Now, so I'm doing this work at the same time I'm a handler for Bill and Hillary. It was just the way the industry was in that day. So I would go get involved with the conquerors, come back. And while I was back cooling off, I'd be with Bill. Bill liked to hear all the war stories, some of which I made up, but he liked to hear them. It just drove him crazy. And I became more and more involved. And then Hillary hated me. She hated Dick Moore. She hated me more. And Hillary, folks, in that day, I don't know today, she's 70 now nearly, in that day she was ACDC. It was hard enough to cover up for the affairs of Bill, but it was extremely difficult to cover up for Hillary and her lesbian affairs. And it was tough, and she was tough. She's a butch in a queer affair, lesbian affair. She's the male dominant, and buddy, she is dominant. And Bill Clinton said time and time again, she had had more women than he had. And Alex will remember the time. Just tell you what kind of woman this was. Hillary Clinton, two Secret Service agents in the White House, heard all this racket up in the living quarters. They go up, there's stuff breaking. They don't know whether to go in because you're not supposed to, but things were breaking. They barged in. And there it was. Hillary in bed with Marky Post, you know, night court, that blonde. They were in bed together, and Bill pulled up a chair and wanted to watch, and Hillary was throwing ashtrays and lamps at him. That's the sicko people we call the Clintons. It's actually quite interesting.
Well, remember the FBI agent that was in the White House that even took exposed that they had crack pipes and Mao Zedong ornaments on the Christmas tree? And again, it just shows who goes to the trouble to desecrate a Christmas tree. It just shows they're deviant.
Yeah, and look, guys, I'm not here to smear them. What I'm here to do is give you a character profile of these people because it's up to us. You know, Alex, it's up to your audience. 3-4 million people. That's how many you got because I damn near talked to all of them. You've got 3-4 million people. That's the army we got to stop them with. And you got to know who they are.
Well, and you know, it's one thing if Hillary's in bed with a bunch of women. You know, obviously, that's all come out now. You were the first to talk about it. But Clinton settled the lawsuits where he rapes the women, and he brutally does it.
That's right. Bill Clinton is a sexual deviant, folks. Sexual deviant. He's not just a good old boy chasing women. No, he's sick. He is sick. And I hate to tell you all this. Hillary, sick. And the only thing I can tell most of you at this point, I'm glad she did what she did in the Benghazi hearing when she said, what difference does it make, they're dead? But y'all saw what Hillary was. That's Hillary. And I'll tell you, most of you don't remember the endless hearing after hearing after hearing when Hillary said, I can't recall. I don't remember. She would remember. Alex, she'd remember everything to the nth detail. And then we get to this one-minute segment that might be incriminating. And she didn't remember. And people didn't know what was going on. Well, we trained them to know in a court of law, folks, if you say yes or no, you can be proven to commit a lie, perjury. If you say you don't know, nobody on earth can prove what you can or can't remember. In fact, and that's what we trained Hillary to do, and that's what she did. And she walked through those hearings. And by the way, folks, in case you don't know, Hillary was so mean, so dishonest, so deceitful, that she worked on the prosecution team after Richard Nixon. But they kicked her off because she was so unprofessional.
That's right. Larry Nichols, stay there. We'll be back. Larry Nichols, the consummate insider that helped get the Clintons lined up for the power structure of Arkansas, which Arkansas, more than any state, is run by the Dixie Mafia. Major newspapers, TV, everything. You're either part of that inside group or you don't operate in business, basically. That's why they love the Clintons, because you either love the Mafia, Don, or you're done. You've got who Clinton's mother was, Lady of the Night, all of it. Notice she died right when he started running for office, or right when he's about to get elected, just like Obama's grandma and all the rest of them. I mean, these are ruthless people that will do anything for power, and they get off on it. And that's why they want full control. I want to go inside their psychology. And I forgot to tell Larry, he's doing a great job, but his phone's lower than it was last time to try to really get in on that mic. And to understand their psychology. It's not fun to go up against these people. But we're going to lose everything if we don't. The Republicans are voting with the Democrats tomorrow to pass TPP that makes the president a dictator and brings us into the world government. The Pope called for world government last week. The Clintons are just really nasty characters in all this that know where the bodies are buried for the larger global mafia, and they will do anything they're told. But if I was the elite, I wouldn't even put them in there as bad as the elite are, because they'll double-cross them. I mean, they are dangerous from what I know. We'll see if Larry Nichols disagrees with that. Larry didn't ask me to do this. He's trying to get his book republished. It was a bestseller. He's working on some other things. You know, he is risking his life doing this. And if folks want to support him, or folks want to write him a letter, or folks want to work with him, he's trying to organize people to get him, you know, on more shows to expose the Clintons. You can write to Larry Nichols, 58 Kingston Drive, Conway, Arkansas, 72034. Larry Nichols, 58 Kensington Drive, Conway, Arkansas 72034. LarryNichols.com is a third-party site, but he endorses it. From what last time I heard, we can ask him on air. But you need to understand, folks, that we're a platform for all these other activists and patriots and people that are under attack as well. I don't want to mess with the Clintons. When they were in, I was called in and I was told, don't talk about Waco, don't talk about the Clintons, don't talk about all this stuff, or you're going to be fired off. I had the number one talk show in town at 24, been on the air 3 years. By then, I'd already started a little syndicated show out of my house, thank God, and they fired me. Then they physically attacked me. And they didn't say this is a message from the Clintons. They said, quit talking about Waco, quit messing with that, you know, judge. I was having demonstrations. They had the Klan come out against me. This is all on video. And they really run a lot of underground stuff because you're dealing with the Dixie Mafia. Interface with these globalists. I mean, it is truly a sickening symbiosis. And I want to get Larry Nichols' take on what Hillary will do when she gets in. Because if you think Obama's been bad, he's been quasi-run by the Clintons. Katie barred the door. They like to crush good people. They like to go after folks that stood up against them. They are truly wicked people. And remember Hillary laughing about Gaddafi destabilizing Africa, putting al-Qaeda in charge? I came, we saw, we killed him. So we'll talk to Larry Nichols here in a moment. I would appreciate if folks would pray for this broadcast, pray for our affiliates, support our local sponsors, become a local sponsor, put a billboard up for Infowars.com if you've got the money. This is the time when if good men and women take action in little ways and big ways and medium-sized ways, they may even get into power, and it may be the beginning of the end of these people because Obama already woke the country up. Imagine Hillary. But they are incredibly arrogant. But the good news is we've had the CIA whistleblowers on, famous ones, Tosh Plumlee, who I want to get back on, and many others. And the military, Colonel Schaefer, Admiral Moore, former chairman of the Joint Chiefs, countless others, Benton K. Parton, the list goes on and on, who have woken up the military. So the good news is the military is one of the most awake groups. And they're beginning to understand what's happening. A lot of the local police are as well. That's why they want to federalize things. This is very serious. But it's very important to also go to InfoWarsStore.com and buy the books, the videos, the T-shirts, the products. We've got 20% off still running. They haven't gotten rid of that special. It was supposed to go last Wednesday, so it'll go tomorrow. We're going to get rid of it today on the ProPure G2 filters in the pitcher form. It's 20% off, huge discount on that. Best deal you're going to find anywhere. Cuts out the glyphosates, the fluoride, basically all of it. We have 20% off until they sell out. We did sell out of the George Washington single-run belt buckles. We have them. Three different designs of Molon Labe, one of them sold out. 20% off on that, made in America, until those sell out. And that special's going. And then we have Liver Shield, our new product out that's on record with these known herbs to flush out the liver. You can also do the deep flush. That informational video is on the page. If you scroll down right there on the Liver Shield page, you can see that the informational video has now been posted at InfoWarsLife.com, so you can watch that video and see how to do the deep cleanse. Simply amazing. InfoWarsLife.com or 888-253-3139. But Larry, you're a classy guy, you know, from the South, so you keep thanking me and giving me credit. I want to give you credit as well. But beyond that, talk about what they'll do if they get full control. This is clearly their end game. They want to graduate to the world government level. Bill Clinton has said that. Obama has said that. And then getting into why do you expose them when you could have just stayed in with them? When was the moment when you'd already done all this dirty stuff that you had that come to Jesus moment, that Saul of Tarsus moment on the road to Damascus? Because I know I'm risking my life. I mean, it's there's a level in me that says don't do this that I have to get past every time, especially when they're getting ready to run for office and they're heating up, that says, listen, you know, you got the sword of Damocles there, but it's in my gut. I can't go on living if I don't fight them. I can't sell out to fear. Plus, they're going to take over everything and destroy our country. Somebody's got to say no. I mean, I think it comes down to that. Why do you fight them Larry Nichols.
Alex, it came down to me when I went to work at AFA, and I was marketing director and handling everything, and I found out that cocaine was being shipped into MENA, and it was being laundered by the state group that I was covering up for. And I realized, Alex, that if my daughter got hooked on cocaine, she and Chelsea are the same age, played together. If she got hooked on cocaine, I couldn't live with myself. And we found out my dad was dying of lung cancer, something I'm doing now myself. But at that time, to be honest, Alex, I couldn't live with my father, the salt of the earth, knowing his son was as terrible as I was. And I just made my decision and reached out, touched the floor. I was sitting in a chair and I touched the floor with my fist and I said, God, I'm at the bottom. Ain't nothing but up from here. And I got after it. Now, I didn't intend for it to be quite the marathon that it became. I didn't intend to be in every newspaper, TV, magazine article in the free world. I didn't intend for all that, but that's where it ended up. And we're not done yet. Alex, the reason all of you must fight, all of you, you got to come to the terms Alex did. Folks, they're going to take it. They're going to take it. You're going to fight them. At some point, you're either going to be in submission, and it's going to be too late to fight.
That's it. I just can't submit and be bound. I just, my instinct is I got to fight them.
Well, that's where you are now. And folks, listen to me, please. You can get hold of me through an email at nicholslive@aol.com. Thanks to you, Alex, a gentleman. Kenneth Cartier said he'd help me and make sure he answered all the emails and got them to me. Fantastic. Never had that before. And then we're redoing the genies out of the bottle. Why do the genies out of the bottle, folks? Because I wrote it to tell you exactly what they would do, how they do it, why they do it. And you'll know ahead of time. And that's how we grow your audience, Alex. You know, when I've been telling all these people, and I guarantee it's been a lot. I've been telling people, gosh, guys, we got to spread the word. And the biggest mistake, Alex, we as conservatives that have seen the light make, is somebody says, well, hey, what do you think about that Hillary? And then, Alex, we just OD and tell them everything we know in a split second, and their eyes start rolling back in their head and calling us conspiracy nuts. I am going to tell you, remember, Alex, what we did before? The scandal a week. I'm going to tell you every week one thing that you're going to tell people that ask you. And then we're going to prove it that week, and they're going to say, whoa, how did you know that? And, Alex, I gave my phone number, 440-897-0611. And everybody said, good God, you put your number out. And on Alex Jones's program, that's risky because you don't get a lot of calls. But I'll tell you, Alex, your audience was reverent. They were not abusive, respectful. It's an honor.
Oh, it's an honor to have this audience. It's because I get pretty obnoxious.
Oh, you're damn right.
And they're really amazing people. Let me ask you this question, because I know that moment many times. When it'll be like 2-3 in the morning, because I'm not afraid right now, but sometimes I wake up in the middle of the night and I go look at my children in the moonlight and I just think, my God, how did I ever get into all this? This is so dangerous. This is so real. We know how real it is. When we get the death threats, the attacks, we see it. And it's that exact thing. I'll just get down on my knees and realize that if I give in to these people and if I back off and if I ever even take one move towards not going all the way, it's a sellout, and my soul's on the line. I realize that, but what about the general public that's in a malaise and never had that decision come to them in their heart, where you're convicted by God, that's what it is, or conscience, whatever atheists want to call it, you're convicted by it, and then you got to make the decision. A lot of people I know have never had that conviction, and I think the most important is we need to convict America's heart to realize, folks, you think stuff's bad now. Look at how it's all speeding up. I mean, we are in deep, you know what? We are in it. And it's, I mean, how bad's it going to get, Larry, in your gut, knowing everything you know, How bad is it going to get if these people get full power again? Because I can just see it written on their faces. They're going for broke. Hell, they'll probably start nuclear war with the Russians. They're crazy.
They're crazy. I'll tell you exactly how it's going to be. 2016, if we don't get together, if we don't draw people to this program and grow an audience, and by audience, I mean an army.
And other shows, too.
If we don't put it in your book, put it in the book. 2016 will be the last damn election this country ever had. Now, there'll be elections like Cuba, don't say that. Russia. But there won't be any elections after 2016. And I can prove it. And I will prove it. We'll prove it, Alex. We'll prove it. But folks, I'm telling you, Hillary is about power. Do you understand? You know now, all of you, how much damn money they got through that foundation. Why would somebody, Alex, 70 years old with all that money, why wouldn't they just go out to pasture? Power. Dictatorial power. Are you still there?
Yes, I am. I'm just thinking.
I'm telling you, it's power.
And the Clintons are getting worse, aren't they? I mean, they seem to get more evil as time goes on.
For yourself, think about it. Don't you know they need that job of president like they need a hole in the head? They're missing something, folks. This is a dynamic duo. Had I not have lived with them, lived in the house with them, had I not have been there, and seen it. You don't realize these people aren't Mr. and Miss America. This is the most dysfunctional couple you've ever, ever, ever met. Number one, Kelsey. Bless her heart. To Bill's credit. Kelsey's not Bill's kid. That's Webb Hubble's kid, and I proved it. Now, to his credit, he raised her, treated her like a father. Hillary be gone. You remember that, don't you, Alex? When you talked to Larry Patterson, Roger Perry, the state police security guard, she'd be gone 6 weeks on the road, come back and pat her on the head like a dog. Never say anything to her. These people want your soul. I know it sounds crazy, y'all. I know it does. But what do I have to do? What have I got to give up? I have given up our home. I have given up everything my family has ever had. And you tell me for what the hell? What the hell did I get out of it, huh? Why does a man do that? Why does a man look at his family at night and can't keep the tears back because I've destroyed them? Why does a man do that? Ain't no money there.
Well, it's because you know that you can't join with the evil. And how do we get America and the world to force them to make the choice? The Bible says you were lukewarm. I spit you out of my mouth. America is lukewarm. It's why we either join with the evil or don't.
All right. That's where it is. It's an either or. We're in the ultimate either or game. If so, then so. Because of Alex, I have this lady that's going to reprint The Genius Out of the Bottle. It's be done in a month. Now, you can go, get this, folks. You can go to listenupaudiobooks.com and get your list, name on the list. And, Alex, this book is about how they do what they do. And you have to know they're going to do exactly what I tell them to do.
It's the Clinton playbook.
It's the playbook. And what frustrates them, I don't know if you remember it, but a couple weeks ago, that ABC guy called me, asked the guy at ABC, I'll tell you his name off air, you know, went to this gathering, there was a friend, so what do you think Hillary's problem to be, da-da-da, and who do you think the top three people, you know, Hillary will have to worry about? And he said, Larry Nichols, Larry Nichols, Larry Nichols, and not in that order.
Now, folks, I saw that in the New York Times. Is attacking you. For folks that don't know who you are, most do. Why haven't they? I mean, I know they've shot at you, threatened you, done a lot of stuff to you. When we come back, we know they want to get you. They could. I wonder why I'm still alive while you're still alive. It's probably God. Plus, they don't want to make us martyrs. But some of their idiot supporters might come after us. But that'll probably blow up in their face. The answer is what Jim Garrison said. Stay in the light. Stay in the light. Larry Nichols straight ahead. Then we've got Max Keiser on the economy and more. We are being conquered right now. The TPP is set to pass the Senate tomorrow. They say they've got the votes. We'll be breaking it down with Max Keiser coming up. We've got Larry Nichols 5 minutes of the next hour. We're going to start having Larry on every few weeks to go over different chapters of this. And the next time he's on, take your phone calls for an hour with your question on the Clintons. But I feel weird, even though I get animated and yell and stuff sometimes out of frustration, sitting here calmly talking about the TPP that is the most transparently tyrannical piece of garbage ever. And by transparent, it's completely opaque. It's completely secret. The sections that have been leaked are nightmare. It transfers total power to the president and foreign groups. Imagine what comes next. Amazing video, last chance to stop fast track Senator Sessions up on Infowars.com. And coming up, $140 billion bond fund goes to cash as it, quote, braces for bond market collapse. We'll talk about that with Keiser. Turmoil coming to the markets. Prepare for bear markets and bonds. Ron Paul. Warren Buffett basically says the same thing. He should know he's a major mafia don of the WASP mob. But he's a nice little old man with an ice cream, so he's nice. I mean, the mob's only Italians, right? That's what I heard on TV, because the media doesn't stereotype things. This is mind control. I'll get into the whole battle flag of Northern Virginia. It's not the Confederate flag. It's known by that. I'm going to break down what's behind that, because if they can ban that, they can ban everything, folks. It's about getting rid of language. I don't have a dog in the fight here. The point is, that's what it's about. One racist crazy uses something, and then now it's got to be banned. The American flag flew over more slaves than the Confederate ever did. We're going to talk about that. But Larry Nichols, we're going to break here in a few minutes. You'll have five more minutes on the other side. I don't wish ill on anybody because I think it's bad luck, just in my gut. Plus, I'll expose the Clintons, but I'm not going to sit there and wish harm on them, because that really, I just feel, opens a metaphysical door for them to be able to attack me. I think, I don't like to shoot my mouth off, is my point. But I do hope that her health, which we know is deteriorated, steps in. And that, you know, God move against these people. It's not just us politically. If we do the right thing, you know, hopefully Hillary will just retire. I mean, what about health problems with her? We know her and Bill have partied quite a bit.
Yeah, I don't see her health problems being a deterrent at all. What we have to do, Alex, is realize one day every man, woman, and child listening right now is going to meet our maker. And you're going to have to answer, every one of us, you're going to have to answer, what did you do when these people were destroying the country God gave us? What are you going to do? And folks, I'm going to tell them I did everything I could. And I'm going to tell you, every person here, if Alex will let me come on, let's say next week, whatever's good for you, Alex, I want everybody listening to me to bring another person with you to listen. That's how we grow our army. And then next week, I will give y'all and your person you brought with you the damnedest true scandal you have ever heard.
Well, that's right. The key is the people. And you're using the show as a microcosm. Bring somebody to the show. Bring them to the information we're putting out and to others. And that's how we're going to win, is word of mouth. And you're absolutely right. Larry Nichols is our guest, back in 70 seconds for five more minutes with him. I'm going to give him the floor to cover whatever he wants. Then we're going to get into the global meltdown that is really building steam, unfortunately. Stay with us. I'm just saying what Larry Nichols is saying is true. Now it's much more dangerous what I do than it's ever been. And in the still of the night, in that quiet place, the Most High, a lot of, you know, atheists ask me, I see the emails, the comments. Man, we're sick of hearing about God. You know, we want the info. We're libertarians or whatever, but please shut up about it. Hey, listen, call it a psychological blanket or whatever. When you have responsibility in children, and when you're messing with killers, and you're messing with people that are taking over, I couldn't do this without my relationship with God, okay? Because I fear God doing the wrong thing. Like Larry Nichols feared making his daddy feel bad. That's an extension, an example of that. He didn't want to do that in front of God or his dad. And to continue down the road, because he had a conscience. And we're dealing with people that don't have a conscience. And when you fight these people all day long, You realize when you don't have a conscience or you give yourself away, you go to rock bottom of evil. You become a demon. And so we're fighting demons, whether it's archetypal or whatever you want to call it, we're fighting demons. And the evil's growing. No one can deny that. And that's why I talk a lot about God, because when it's in the still of the night and I wake up and my flesh says, you got to stop doing this, man, you're in danger. Kind of like back when I used to drive a car 150 miles an hour. And I said, you know what, I'm growing up. My wife's pregnant. I better stop driving fast. It's the same thing. It's danger, Will Robinson. You got to quit right now. And it's the same thing. But in my mind, God touches me and says, listen, you think about all these innocent people they've killed, what we're going to do to everybody. You've got to stand against them, and then I have comfort. Only got about 3 minutes left. Larry Nichols, closing comments, and we'll get you back on next week to break one of those major scandals and also take some phone calls. Larry Nichols, go ahead.
You bet. Well, let me just say this once again, Alex. Thank you for letting me come on. This is where I'll hope. This is where I'll be. This is where I will break a scandal every week. Now, to show you a little bit of what I'm talking about, Alex, one thing you and I got a rule we had before, and I hope we have it again. If you ever catch me lying, you will come on the air and call me a liar and destroy me everywhere you can.
But, Larry, everything you said's basically already come out and been proven true. I mean, we know you're telling the truth.
Well, I know, but there's some more I'm going to tell you. That was all about Bill here. Bill, typically, let me give you one. Just a sample of what you need to bring somebody next week with you to this program. Y'all may not know it, but back when Hillary was first lady, she would go on the weekends to California with Linda Budworth Thomason and some of the others, ladies that decided women. And they went to a church for witches. 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 Now, do you want your president? Remember that lady that was trying to run for the Senate, and sometimes she'd gone to some place where they did witch stuff? Hillary went to a church and worshipped Satan. You want me to bring the state police that were with her? Do you want me to tell you?
Wow. Well, I know actually some of that came out, and Tony Blair's wife does that too. That came out in the news.
Yeah. Well, here we go, folks. We're going to learn about the real Hillary and what's scary, Alex, what I think is scaring the hell out of you. There are people that love them no matter what. And they'll do what they got to do to protect them. They don't need somebody to tell them to go shoot somebody. What about John Hinckley? What about that kind of people? That's what Alex Jones faces. Me too, I guess. But just know this, folks. You're either going to be in submission or you're going to win for your family. And there's got to be something in every one of y'all out there. There's got to be something in your home, someone, some cow, some dog, some car, something that you love so much that you'll forego all of the humiliation, all of the everything.
To protect it. Great points. We'll talk to you again next Wednesday if you can do it. Or, you know, I don't want to have to take on Hillary Clinton. Her people were at Bilderberg. She's the one. Jeb Bush is the ringer. I'd be against him as well, but she's the one. Just like Obama was the one 7 years ago. They're dangerous. They're the worst to go up against. But you have to make a decision in life what you stand for. And I'm just having flashbacks to going up against the Clintons at a very low level 16, 17 years ago, and how disgusting that experience was. But at the end of the day, I feel good. I feel strong. I feel brave. And any fear I have only makes me stronger and is transmuted into strength and honor. But I want to believe in the people of this country and the people of the world to say no to war with Russia, no to arming ISIS to run around murdering non-radical Muslims and Christians, no to destabilizing the planet, no to the megabanks, no to the moves to turn us into a prison economy. They're going to try to pass the TPP tomorrow. I almost got champagne. I only did that one other time when we got the Copenhagen Treaty shot down for carbon taxes, got the secret document that it doubled taxes on the third world, blew that up. But I knew they'd be back. But we'll be back too. This is an eternal fight. And the reason evil's taking over is people decided they can just be spectators. You're not even alive when you just roll over to this dehumanization. And look at how the Democrats are the ones trying to shoot down TPP. It's cut and dry. They're going against their own president. It gives the president dictatorial power to let foreign groups do whatever they want. The three sections we've got are a giant screw job. And there are the Democrats doing the right thing, and the Republican leadership, a bunch of scum, going along with it. It makes me want to turn the desk over, pull my hair out. I mean, do you understand, folks? If they can do this, they can do anything. We do have Max Kaiser. Okay, good. We're still working. His Skype was down, and we're trying to get around it. And just get him on the phone. That's fine. I wanted to play this clip and get into the whole Confederate flag thing. Regardless of what you think about the Confederate flag, the Northern Virginia Army battle flag, which then became the personal flag that signified Robert E. Lee, the hero of the South. That's what it symbolizes. Had nothing to do with slavery. He didn't like slavery, criticized it. He was a top Northern general, the commandant of West Point. They wanted him to run for president of the United States. His father was a super famous top general, right-hand man to George Washington, probably a better general than Washington. He was one of the most popular people when he died in the North. And yeah, ne'er-do-wells and others have got it to be hateful. Other people, it's about pride. The South was reconstructed and put under a living hell for 10 years, and it became a symbol of defiance against that. But it's being banned, and the governor's calling for it to be banned, just as a feel-good stunt. And they're not going to stop there. It's going to be other symbols and other things. And people are saying pull down statues of Civil War heroes. I mean, it's just insane. The war was never even about slavery. It's just all made up. In mainline history books, they admit it was just a side issue. Christians in the North and the South were against slavery, and they got it banned all over the world. Started in England. Catholics and Protestants got it banned. Slavery still goes on in many areas where Christians aren't in control. But the public thinks it's Western culture that invented slavery. It's Western culture that ended slavery. The historical ignorance of the public is mind-boggling. And now the president, I watched how they got O.J. Simpson off playing racism. And they'd get up and use the N-word over and over again, knowing it's incendiary. And then notice the media blurps the N-word when the president says it. Hey, it's the president. Isn't he allowed to say it? He's black, supposedly. And, of course, Shikari did an excellent report. Zero Hedge did one as well, breaking down there are more slaves today than ever before. And people think, every time I say we've got to end white slavery, I get emails going, don't you care about black slaves? White slavery means sexual. That's the term it's had for about 1,000 years. Sex slavery is called white. And then they've got the hardcore black slavery. It has nothing to do with blacks. It's like white magic, black magic. It means the really harsh type. And Christians ended slavery in Europe 1,000 years ago, except in Germany it was serfdom and other areas. They changed the name, and so they had to have a new group to grab. And so they started going and grabbing Africans and taking them to the Caribbean where Christians weren't because they wouldn't put up with it. But, I mean, the public is just ignorant about all of this. And it's very, very frustrating. And now we have the president running around using the N-word, rubbing salt in the wound, because it's all they've got to create a political diversion. Let's go ahead and play that clip.
That's still part of our DNA. That's passed on. We're not cured of it.
Racism.
We are not cured of.
Clearly.
And it's not just a matter of it not being polite to say in public. That's not the measure of whether racism still exists or not.
I mean, you talk about bull. See, we now think our rights is to have a sex change paid for by taxpayers, or our right is to be able to pay for illegals to have free health care. No, a right is that you have your private property and can be left alone and do whatever you want as long as it doesn't hurt somebody else. And so they're taking all of our real rights collectively right now. I mean, we're going under foreign world government right now. And you would think the only thing that exists on this planet is Jenner or the Confederate battle flag. And regardless what you think about it, the distortion of everything is mind-blowing. Now, I wanted to get Max Keiser on. We were able to get him. We're going to break here in a few minutes because he's been warning for about 3 years of a world bond meltdown. He predicted it would happen by last winter. There were some jitters then, but it didn't happen. It's bold to set a date, but he's had a lot of predictions come true. It certainly is the biggest bubble ever. Well, now a $140 billion bond fund is going to cash as it braces for bond market collapse. We'll tell you who's saying that. We've got a lot of other analysts saying it. Turmoil coming to the markets. Prepare for bear markets and bonds. Ron Paul. Warren Buffett's basically saying the same thing. Europe is having a move towards bank runs. They're wanting to restrict cash and have bail-ins. I mean, something this way wicked comes. Max Keiser, where are we right now?
Hey, Alex Jones. It is a pleasure to be back with you. Now, let's talk about the bond apocalypse. As you mentioned, I was a bit early in my call. I was looking for this last year. You know, this has been something people have been talking about for a number of years because the way to get out of all of the financial problems over the past 20 years has always been to, quote, extend and pretend, which means wrap it all up in a fresh bond and offer it again, but with a lower interest rate and with a longer maturity date. And this has been going on for many years, but now we're at the end game. The globe now has $200 trillion of debt. And keep in mind that the total GDP of the world is roughly $60 trillion.
But I thought derivatives were over $2 quadrillion.
Well, the GDP versus the debt, the actual debt on the books, not derivatives.
We're yeah, but the real debt is $200 trillion, yeah.
$200 trillion in actual debt, not in the shadow banking system with the derivatives and all the stuff that they don't count, but the actual debt that people count, the national debt, corporate debt, all this debt, mortgage debt, $200 trillion worth of debt. There's a huge amount of debt, and as a lot of pundits are now saying, we're at the point where you simply can't add any more debt.
All right, stay there. It's really important information, MaxKeiser.com. Thank you for joining us, Max Keiser. We're going to look at this. I mean, look, he said we were going to have the baby when it was 10 months pregnant, the woman. Now it's like 14, 15 months pregnant. Max says it looks like it's going to pop. Maybe he's wrong. Maybe the gestation period's now, you know, 50 years. Coming up with Max Keiser, hit some of the other headlines that are at InfoWars.com. Max Keiser, inventor of virtual trading technology, used widely around the world, successful stockbroker, author, TV host with Al Jazeera, BBC, RT, you name it. Max, go ahead. You got interrupted by the break. You were getting into what's happening with the technicals, what's going on worldwide, and the preparation for collapse we see. Please continue.
Yeah, imagine you're trying to sell a kilo of cocaine, okay? Now, what you do, we know from watching movies like about drug dealers that they cut the cocaine with something like, you know, whatever, baby laxative or whatever they put in there to make the kilo appear like 5 kilos or 10 kilos. Now, what's happened in the bond market is that 20 years ago, you had a certain amount of AAA rated sovereign government debt, the good stuff, pure government AAA rated bonds. But for 20 years now, they keep adding junk bonds to the mix. They put the junk bonds in our pension funds. They put the junk bonds in our corporations. They put the junk bonds in our municipalities. So when you cut, any drug dealer knows, if you cut, eventually you end up with nothing. You can't sell it. It's garbage. And that's where the bond market is today. It's been cut so many times with junk bonds and garbage and false accounting and misallocation, that now the global bond market is completely polluted. There's nothing that nobody wants on these sovereign bonds anymore. To give you an idea how bad the situation is, the U.S. 10-year Treasury bond hasn't traded, the yield hasn't been this low for 240 years. That's right. The entire history of America, there's never been a period where the bonds have been so hated. What about the United Kingdom? Well, in the 300 years since the Bank of England, similar situation. They've never had the yields at these low levels because nobody wants this paper anymore, no matter how much they force them to buy it. And what we're seeing, in my view, Alex, is that the social unrest, the violence in America and around the world is the result of a financial dislocation and a financial problem. So when people say, well, when's the big collapse coming? The answer is that it's happening right now. That's what all this violence is about. It's about towns and municipalities and societies falling apart. They can't pay their bills anymore. The sewage is being turned off. The basic services are being turned off. Here in London, they're firing firemen, policemen, teachers. They're being forced out of London because they've run out of money. Now, the bond dealers, the people who create those bonds, the $200 trillion worth of debt, to hide the fact that society is breaking apart, they get a fee, and they are fabulously wealthy. You mentioned Warren Buffett. He's a good example. He's in the business of selling the bonds. He's in the business of expanding the debt, so he gets wealthy. But everyone else is falling apart, and we see this incredible rise of violence. In my view, it's beyond the race question. The race question is a smokescreen. The real truth is that you've got a cadre of bankers on Wall Street in the City of London, here in London, who have destroyed the economy, and people don't know where to turn. They become violent, and the race motivation is a smokescreen for class war between bankers and everybody else. And we see it now in the bond markets falling apart. So and what does that mean to the average person? It means that interest rates, which are the inverse of a bond price, start to go up. So your mortgage suddenly goes up 5 or 6%.
And we know real interest rates are starting to creep up, but the elite still give themselves 0% interest so they can consolidate power at a real detriment to the real economy. But they don't seem to care and then put out false economic numbers telling us everything's peachy keen. How long can this go on?
Well, we've seen a couple of examples of different scenarios. So in Iceland, they said no to the bankers. They let their currency collapse, and they've restarted their economy, and now they're the fastest-growing economy in Europe. In Greece, they are going to do a deal with the European Central Bank and the IMF to do this extend and pretend. They're going to load them up with more debt anyway, and they're going to continue being a vassal state to Germany and the ECB and the IMF. So they're going to use debt slavery in Greece. That's what it looks like. Greece was looks like they're going to fail in standing up to the slave masters at the IMF. They are not going to do in Iceland. So they will continue being a slave. So the European Central Bank essentially absorbs all of Greece's debt. They'll take on another, you know, $400 or $500 billion.
Stay there and explain it to us. Long segment coming up. And I agree with you. The collapse has been incremental for a while. It's going quicker now. Will there be some big events like Ron Paul's talking about? Max Kaiser's our guest. I'm Alex Jones. Stay with us. I don't take the interpretation of quack scientists saying life just spontaneously began. And it's the same thing when I use terms like a new age. I don't mean that in the new agey sense. I mean, we're coming to an end, like Iron Age, Bronze Age, you know, Stone Age, Industrial Age, Computer Age. We're coming to the end of an age. All these mega bubbles, all the corruption, government gearing up with corporations to suppress people during the crisis, Ministry of Defense, Pentagon reports. It's all admitted to a learned person. Liberal just means well-learned in the ancient text. I'm a super liberal in that I'm into information. I'm into how things work. I don't claim to be the smartest guy around. But when the globalists have written thousands of books and publications telling us exactly what they're going to do, I can get up here and tell you what's coming, and then it happens. It doesn't mean it happens exactly how we said or when, but in the general sense, we're dead on in that dead reckoning spectrum. Some people act like Max Keiser and myself or Ron Paul are trying to implode things. No. If a woman's 9 months pregnant and her water's broke, you can say, hey, I bet she goes into labor the next few days. It ain't rocket science. You looked at Zimbabwe 15 years ago when they started hyper-accelerating their printing presses. They had a boom at first. Every economist said that's going to cause hyperinflation and total implosion. It's a failed state now. Same thing with Weimar Germany. Same thing with Mexico. Devaluing their currency. Argentina. I mean, the laws are not suspended. They've just figured out ways to prop it up. And I'll give the analogy of my best friend growing up who went to the hospital over a cut toe, I think it was. He got an infection, got into his guts, got into his bloodstream, killed him. And I was there at the hospital, had to go off the radio. They said he's taking a turn for the worse. I went off the radio. I went over there. And they were waiting for his dad to get here from Dallas, driving like 90 miles an hour. And the nurses said, look, he's going to die. If we don't keep giving him adrenaline, he's going to die. And they said, we think we can give him adrenaline one more time. Might keep him alive for about an hour. And he was on a respirator. But he was conscious looking at me. And I went in there. The first they wanted me to get him to fight and everything. And he was, trying to fight, but he couldn't talk with the thing down his throat. You could see him in his eyes looking at me and tears come out of his eyes. But, man, I was there right before his dad got there. They gave him that last thing of adrenaline. It jacked him up for a while, and then his eyes went glazed. They looked at him, and they said, he's dead. They took him off the respirator that night. I remember sitting in there. He was peacefully dead. This country and this world economy is dead already. It's on a respirator. Of QE Unlimited. And all I know is the elites are building bunkers and running to the hills. I told you that first. It's in the news now. And I talked to big wigs this week. A lot of them, not just the two I talked to over the weekend. Now I've talked to more. And there is a hysteria in the elite. And you're seeing it in the news now. Now, I hope the bubble doesn't pop now. This is going to be so painful, but it can't go on forever. I had Schiff on yesterday, and he said, no, we need to pop it before it gets bigger. It's more dangerous. Max Keiser, you've got the floor for the next 12, 14 minutes or so. You were going over, you know, they keep cutting the cocaine. They keep cutting the bonds down to where it's nothing but talcum powder now. People are realizing that. Folks keep buying U.S. bonds because they know if it goes under, everything goes under. But at some point, it's like a snake eating itself. I mean, it's craziness. And then the general yuppie public just thinks everything's wonderful because, you know, they can watch Caitlyn Jenner or whatever his name is. I mean, I'm not against Caitlyn Jenner. I just don't care. I mean, it's mental illness that we promote all this stuff that doesn't matter at the end of the day in Confederate battle flag fights. And just we're fighting over who polished the silverware the best on the deck of the Titanic's what I'm getting at. And I look at this economy like my friend, dead already. Or it's kind of like use the Wrath of Khan analogy of Spock goes in to fix the reactor and Kirk wants to go in to save him. And they grab him. They say, look, you know, he'll die if I don't get him out. And they go, look, he's dead already. I don't know how long till Spock hits the ground. But, I mean, he's leaning over right now. His skin's burned off. I mean, and people are sitting there to us. It's not bad. It's not bad. You're a liar. You're a fearmonger. And we're just looking at weapons moving in with NATO to have war with Russia. Our government's so crazy they fund Al-Qaeda to murder every Christian they find. I mean, we got really evil people in charge. And every instinct I've got is just get off the air, get out of here. Roll over to the globalists and just run with my family. But I'm not going to do that, Max. And I'm 100% saying what I believe, what I see happening. How long can this go on? What is the state of the world? What will the accelerated meltdown look like?
Well, first of all, I have to ask, there are people who confuse you with the New Age, incense burning, Birkenstock sandal wearing, yoga, Vedic master. I'm shocked. Alex Jones of Austin, Texas, worshiping crystals?
No. What I'm getting at is I say we're coming to the end of an age, clearly. Clearly the end of an age is here.
I get it. So listen.
No, but I'm asking you, are we not at the end of an age?
You know, like they have to fund themselves and they sell bonds, right? And what's happened is that they have starting to buy their own bonds. Because nobody else wants to buy them out there. So they're buying their own bonds. Because if they stop buying their own bonds, then the bond markets collapse and interest rates go high and everything falls apart like it did in 2008. So in 2008, everything came to a dead stop. And suddenly they printed $60 trillion. The debt of the globe went from $140 trillion to $200 trillion. They printed $60 trillion to essentially buy back their own mistakes. The theory is, why do they do this? Well, the theory is that we're going to fake it till we make it. You know, we're going to keep interest rates low, and this is going to get people to start businesses, and wages are going to go higher, and taxes are going to go up. And once we get those taxes, we're going to pay down this debt. Well, it hasn't happened in 7 years. There hasn't been enough tax revenue to pay down the debt. Therefore, the debt keeps on going higher and higher. And at some point, you just have a capitulation where there's nobody left. There's no greater fool left. There's no more room to buy, to eat your own vomit, essentially, is what the central bank is doing. And you have a repeat of 2008. But it just is much worse because there was never any reform. Barack Obama, in my opinion, the greatest failure of his presidency is that when he took office, he bailed out the bankers instead of bailing out Main Street. He could have very easily bailed out Main Street. He could have bailed out the mortgage holders, not the mortgage underwriters. And this whole crisis could have been averted after maybe 2.5 years of a gut-wrenching adjustment. We would now be expanding. People would be a lot more hopeful. And we wouldn't see this race, violence erupt because people would be too busy making hand over fist money, and the United States would be a world leader. Instead, he bailed out the bankers. He left Main Street to rot. So you have municipalities, infrastructure, potholes, bridges just crumbling.
And that's because they're greedy and want it to implode so they can buy it up for pennies on the dollar. But only a suicide banker, the term you coined, would do that because the conflagration is so incredibly dangerous.
There's so many suicide bankers now. There's another, like, every week. There's another banker because they feel so ashamed of being in that industry and participating in financial terrorism that either they just outright kill themselves out of embarrassment to be associated with the likes of Jamie Dimon or Lloyd Blankfein, or they just blow themselves up because, you know, they've lost their mind. But when you give guys unlimited credit at 0% interest and every time they make a mistake, the government bails them out, you know, you're encouraging psychosis on a mass scale.
Well, I disagree with you. I think most of these hundreds of bankers dying a year are being murdered.
Well, in the case of J.P. Morgan, you know, when you work for them, and I worked on Wall Street for many years, you know, when you do a life insurance contract, it's in the name of the firm, not in the name of your family. So if you're dead, the firm gets the death benefit, not your family.
Well, aren't these guys the biggest gangsters ever? You told the story, was it J.P. Morgan calling up? Or was it Goldman Sachs?
Oh, Corzine, and said, listen, you give us our $1 billion or we're going to kill you. And my understanding is that he threatened to kill John Corzine during the MF Global scandal. They got paid the $1 billion ahead of any other creditor, but totally broke the law. That's a completely unlawful act of security.
Well, listen,
violation.
You've been there. I've been there at the highest levels of some major business and also Hollywood. When you get in these rooms with these guys, they are beyond gangsters out of movies. And they really do. I mean, that's who they are. The public is so naive.
Well, the public doesn't have any sense that there are victims to these financial crimes. But in my view, the way society is breaking apart in America is because the economy is breaking apart in America. So it doesn't make sense to say, well, when is the big bond bubble going to collapse? Because by then, if you're not prepared, it'll be too late. And during this interim period, all of these portions of society are breaking down anyway. So this is happening right now. It's happening in real time. It's here. So it's not about the absolute moment when you suddenly have a bond apocalypse and there's another 2008-like scenario. If you're not completely prepared at that point, you know, it'll be too late. But you should know that you're already experiencing a degradation in your society, in your country, because of the massive quantities of wealth that have been stolen by the folks that we've been talking about.
Sure.
Well,
except for a few chosen cities, a few chosen areas, like Austin, Texas, like some areas of Orange County, you drive around the country, I've been all over it, it looks like a bombed-out third-world war zone. Compared to what it looked like decades ago when I went on road trips across this nation. I mean, this country.
Well, what happens is it becomes generational. So now you've got the whole generation people that are just now 20, 21, 22, who have don't know anything different. So they grew up without, their expectations are that America is a second world country, that America is a third world country. They never, they have no memory of America from even the 1980s. And when I started working on Wall Street in the 1980s, the wages in America were still relatively quite high. You could have a single family breadwinner. You could have people going to school without incurring huge amounts of debt. You could get a decent... I walked onto a brokerage firm in 1983, got a job on the spot, and became very, very successful pretty quickly without any training in that field whatsoever because the opportunities were there. There were many firms on Wall Street. Now, they've all been either gone bankrupt or been taken over. Now, you only have two or three firms on Wall Street. There's, I mean, Merrill Lynch has now been taken over.
Yeah, I was talking to a well-known former owner of a large brokerage company that managed billions, and he just said, you know, about 6 months before 2008, he sold it all, got out, and he said because the writing was already on the wall that the regulators would shut you down even if you followed all the rules because they were run by the big three brokerage houses that were consolidating, and
but,
it's a mafia.
They put up these huge barriers to entry, and it's all crony capitalism. So, you know, when I was working on Wall Street in the early 80s, there was stories of shoeshine boys who got their broker's license and became incredibly successful. You never hear about stories like that anymore because all those avenues toward progress have been completely shut down now. It's now a closed shop. It's the way it was back in the 50s and 60s where it was the old boys and it was all very controlled. And because that's where the access of the money is. When the Fed prints $100 billion, you know, just or $1 trillion, it's distributed through the primary dealer system. There's, I think, 18 primary dealers. They're on Wall Street. They're big names that you would be familiar with. They're the ones that get the money first, and then their job is to distribute the money by reselling the bonds and reselling securities. So if you have a job at one of those groups, one of those firms, and there's only a few where you can get it, they're more institutional-oriented, they're not retail-oriented, but if you're working inside one of those firms, you're literally given, you know, you walk into the office every day, and the government gives you $1 million. And they say, can you resell this $1 million and keep 60,000 bucks for yourself? And we're going to do this every single day for the next 5 years. That's your job. Just resell what we just gave you, and you make $50,000 a day.
Sure.
It takes about an hour. I mean, when I worked on Wall Street, if you work more than 2 hours a day, you know, you are an idiot. Because at that point, it was during that incredible bull market of the 1980s. And this money was pouring in like crazy. Then it's not the same anymore. But in the bond market, though, in the sovereign bond market, the government bond market, the thing that's keeping this Titanic partially afloat is huge. And it's free money. They just give it to these
sure.
guys.
When will the adrenaline stop working and how do we kill over?
You have this, like a 2008, nothing changed to stop the problems of 2008. And what happened in 2008 is that banks stopped trusting each other, so they stopped lending to each other. So you have a credit freeze. Credit is no longer moving, so you have essentially everything comes to a halt. And money very quickly runs out. The actual cash in the system, there's not really actually any cash. I mean, the cash at the ATM machine, that kind of cash, it's minuscule compared to the electronic cash. The electronic cash is probably 98, 99% of all cash. None of that becomes available. Only the physical stuff in the ATMs is available. That runs out in 3 or 4 days. Now it's gone. And now you're sitting there with no cash, no access to cash, and the system is frozen. So then you have a completely different reality. You have people that have been listening to your show that have something to trade for. They've got, you know, some gold, some silver.
That was my next question, Max. In the time we have, in the time we have, what do you make of Texas wanting its gold back from the New York private Fed and the Germans and everybody else?
Texas isn't stupid. You know, I mean, the guy who was behind that, very long-standing Wall Street stalwart. The name escapes me, but he's from a long line Texas family. The name I'll think of the second we hang up. But you know, he's the one who put that in place. He knows the writing's on the wall. The insiders know. That, like the Roadrunner cartoon, when Wile E. Coyote is running off the cliff, there's a few seconds where he's still up there in the air, and he's pounding his legs. And you look at him and you say, hey, dude, you know, you've run out of a cliff. You know, you're about to collapse. That's what the insiders know. We've got the Wile E. Coyote moment. So the Texas very wisely have repatriated. So has Austria. So has Russia's buying thousands of tons of gold. Germany China's been buying gold. Germany already has a lot of gold. The insiders are buying and accumulating the gold. Texas doing a very smart move by doing. You got to look at that. And if that is not telling you something, you're not listening. You're not listening to what's happening.
Okay. Well, obviously the collapse has already begun in the third world. Millions more are starving every year. Riots all over the planet. It hasn't completely hit here yet, but the water's rising towards our higher islands that are really just mountains, you know, here on the bottom of the sea, sticking up above the surface. Is there bigger moments where the collapse accelerates?
Well, I mean, you remember 2008. It was not that long ago. The entire world economy had come to a grinding halt. And you had every bank on Wall Street was facing insolvency. And there was panic. And they got together and they said, okay, we're all going to work together, except for Lehman Brothers. Lehman Brothers, because they wouldn't play
Tell
ball.
Us about it in the final segment, MaxKaiser.com. Absolutely. What is the next new mega bailout? What is it? Remember, the system does not like this show. They really hope you don't take the stories and email them and text them and post them on Facebook and Twitter. Rebel flag controversy. Why not just ban Democratic Party for its link to racism? Very important article. Council of Conservative Citizens adds to race dialogue as race war brews in America, which they want to distract us from the social unrest and make it racial. Google secretly testing self-driving cars in Austin, Texas. Sick new ISIS execution video emerges of prisoners having heads blown off, being drowned in cages and blown up in a car. Google secretly spying on computer users via microphones. U.S. will permanently position heavy weapons on Russian border. You know, what about that? I was getting into the economy and gold and all the things that are happening. But what about now NATO saying they're going to have logistics, commandos, fighter bombers directly in Ukraine attacking the Russians? I mean, this, and it's not even a big news item. It's just like, oh, we're sick of hearing about Ukraine. Big deal. It really is mental illness. What are the establishment people thinking, Max Kaiser? Or is this threat of war meant to prop up the financial system somehow?
To Ukraine, that we know you can't pay back our loans, but we're going to give you the money anyway. And then they turn around and tell Greece that you can't pay back the loans, so we're not going to give you any money. Well, you know, so why is the IMF, Christine Lagarde, why are they dictating global geopolitics? They're not an elected body. Nobody put them in charge. They're just a bank. This is an example of what we're saying, where the bankers take over and they start dictating policy. So they're saying, IMF is saying to Greece, you have to starve. You have to be Germany's debt slave. Then they turn around to Ukraine and say, oh, we love you, Ukraine. We love you. Here's all the money. We know you can't pay it back, but we'll give you another $50 billion. So why? What's the double standard there? There's no explanation why Ukraine is...
Well, they totally control Ukraine, and they're giving it to Joe Biden's son.
I mean, you're going to put money... There's no chance in a zillion you're ever going to see any of that back. At least with Greece, they have some kind of, you know, economy with olives and tourism.
It is insane, but I mean, look.
Going now? You just said a moment ago, you were talking about truck drivers, you know, these Google cars, the auto-driving cars. You know that the number one job in 39 states in America is truck driver. So imagine when these self-driving trucks take to the highway. That's the number one job in 39 states in America. That's going to be a huge wave of unemployment on top of the current unemployment. That just means more violence, more unrest, more tension. Why? For what purpose? Who does it serve? Who's writing these knucklehead ideas into their policies? Makes no sense.
Do five more minutes with us because I forgot to get to the points you wanted to cover. Experimenting with virtual reality, financial services enter the matrix. That's a story out of TechCrunch you sent me. And Max Kaiser...
I told you about it.
J.P. Morgan, big article about that, says that he is the devil incarnate.
Oh, yeah. I said that the devil incarnate is Blythe Masters. I made that point. I was up in Belfast. And Blythe Masters is trying to control Bitcoin. And as you know, I'm a big Bitcoin supporter. And now she is in league with some very unscrupulous people, and they're trying to take over Bitcoin. So the battle is on. The fight is on. It's Max Keiser versus Blythe Masters once again. After we battled in the silver market, now we're battling in the Bitcoin market. She is by far, of all the corrupt bankers on Wall Street that have come through there in the last 30 years.
Stay there. I want to come back, and I want to end this main transmission with Emperor Palpatine. You can't stop me. Darth Vader will become more powerful than either of us. Finishing up with Max Keiser, Infowars.com, MaxKeiser.com. You can follow him on Twitter by going there to that site. Max, everything's getting more and more gamed. You brought up the driverless cars. Time Magazine and others have said, get rid of humans driving. Robots are better. Well, how about kill all the humans and say robots are better? It's like this anti-human view of the elite is translating down, but globalism destroys the market. It's consolidating. And then these globalists just think they're going to run off to their armored redoubts and be safe forever. They're crazy.
Eugenicism, techno-eugenics. They're creating the master race of robot slaves. So, I mean, getting back to Ukraine for a second, any 9-year-old with an internet connection can see after 5 minutes that Ukraine is being run by Nazis. And the IMF is mostly owned by America. So America supports Nazis in the Ukraine. Simultaneously, the IMF is saying, well, you know, Greece has to restructure in a way that pleases Germany. And Germany, by the way, is still, they're filling the sores from the original Nazis. So, you know, the Nazi theme is running quite rampant through the IMF right now.
Well, the EU was a Nazi project.
No kidding. So the Greeks are understandably upset, but, you know, they, like many people before, when you have an economic collapse, you suddenly you lose most of your ability to fight back. That's why in America right now, people still have the ability to fight back against the real oppressors.
To vote with their dollars.
Their time on the street fighting each other over silly stuff. They really don't understand what the threat is, and they're not organizing in a way that is going to meaningfully preserve the freedoms that they have come to enjoy. And it's really sad to see that. I can see it clearly because I'm not in the United States, so I get to look at it from a kind of a big picture view. But I can see that on an interstellar basis, town, man, woman, they're engaged in these little fights that are going, and they're sleepwalking into tyranny. I'll say that. America is sleepwalking into tyranny. Very sad, but it looks irreversible at this point.
And the establishment has made the conscious decision to do it. What do you make of TPP and the arrogance that they're about to pass it tomorrow?
Well, TPP just gives, he throws the keys of the castle to a bunch of corporations that are eugenicists.
Like, who are known to loot every country they get to the ground.
Yeah, Monsanto is pure eugenicism, pure eugenics, Monsanto. They're huge. The copyright cartel. You know who's really putting up a good fight right now? I'd say that the number one threat to the monopolists right now is Kim.com. Kim.com is putting together a new company called MegaNet, and MegaNet is going to challenge the internet by introducing a new internet that's going to run on the spare capacity of people's smartphones.
By the way, Kim invited Leanne out there before he even announced that, and it never happened. I need to get an update from Leanne McAdoo. But maybe.
Oh, yeah, well, this is going to be a completely encrypted internet. He has gone to war with the copyright lobby, and the copyright lobby is very ugly and pernicious out there in Hollywood. And, you know, he's making big strides. He's got some legal victories.
Just say what they are. Hollywood is run by the Italian and Jewish mafia.
It's run by the copyright cartel, who believes that they have perpetual ownership of ideas. And that if we've talked about this before, once they have perpetual ownership on all ideas, if you so much as put a word like Disney in an email, you're going to get a bill.
Oh, yeah, they're openly saying that, exactly. Yeah. And then this panopticonic surveillance grid everybody loves is meant to tax and track you at every level. And again, you just got a bunch of mafias, Dixie mafias, everything is running wild.
It's all digital, so it's all easy to track. The databases, the cost of, you know, the cost of
tax collecting.
Digital storage, digital transmission and digital processing over the past 30 years has collapsed.
And that's why they want global taxes.
Build a storage unit in Utah where they store every single email and voicemail.
Thank you, Max. Great job.